I've seen you from a distance. Now I feel you coming near. I've heard of your great power. Now I see you standing here. I fall like I am dead. My face is to the ground. For my eyes have beheld the risen Son of Man.
Turn my mic on there. There we go. This morning is the first Sunday in the season of Lent, and we're going to hear about Jesus being tempted in the wilderness for 40 days by Satan. And you can see in this picture, the angels are ministering to him, or helping Jesus as he is tempted by Satan. This is one of the details that comes out of our Gospel of Mark. And so we're going to look through Jesus' suffering throughout the season of Lent. Today, particularly looking at his suffering by the temptations of Satan. And then there's also going to be midweek Lent services, which will look at the five wounds of Christ. And so we'll get a sermon, and the theme will be revolving around the five wounds of Christ as he went to the cross. The announcements for this week, I did not put this up here, but I forgot to put this in the bulletin as well, but we are praying for Susan Dole this morning, who I was informed went into hospital with, as far as I know, with COVID or some sort of pneumonia of that sort. So we continue to pray for her. I have not heard any updates yet from or about her, so we'll have her in the prayers of the church. Bible study today and every Sunday at 9:45 a.m. I confess that I was not there this morning. I fell a little bit behind this week, but I encourage you to be a part of this Bible study, and I will continue to be a part of the Bible study as well. It is very important for us to be a part of God's Word and to listen to Him in this way. There's also an apologetic study on Thursdays at 7 p.m., both in the sanctuary and live through our YouTube channel. Also, the prayer for carers. I didn't update this, but we're looking for 18 total. Now we've filled some of these spots. We're still looking for 13 prayer warriors who can add the names of two specific Lutheran Early Learning Center staff members to their daily prayers for 1 year. So if you're interested in praying, this is a worthy cause and a worthy thing to do as the church, to pray for people in the church and to pray specifically for the people in the LELC who we are in partnership with. So if you're interested, talk to Sherry. Her email is there if you would like to sign up for that. I'll also just mention quickly that the baptismal font has been placed at the entrance of the sanctuary, and it is open with water in it today. This is to remind you of your baptism as you come in to the sanctuary each Sunday. And normally we have it just up here for baptisms, but with the season of Lent, we ponder and we think about our sinful nature, and it's also helpful, though, to have that hope of our baptism into Christ, right? And so every time you come into the sanctuary on Sunday, you will have the baptismal font there to remind you of your baptism into Christ. With that said, I invite you to we'll remain seated for our first hymn, 707, "Oh, that the Lord would guide my ways."
Oh, that my God.
I invite you to stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the service of the word, speaking the introit responsively. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. Because you have made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High, who is my refuge. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up. You will tread on the lion and the adder. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble, and I will rescue him and honor him. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord God, you led your ancient people through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land. Guide the people of your church that following our Savior, we may walk through the wilderness of this world toward the glory of the world to come. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. I invite you to be seated for the readings from Holy Scripture.
The Old Testament reading is from Genesis chapter 22. After this, God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering, and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. And Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey, and I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you." And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac, his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went, both of them, together. And Isaac said to his father Abraham, "My father," and he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So they went, both of them, together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of that place, "The Lord will provide," as it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord shall be provided." And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham the second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, declared the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you, and you will surely multiply your offsprings as the stars of heaven and as the sand as is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gates of his enemies. And in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll speak the gradual together.
O come, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God.
The epistle is from James chapter 1. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. From when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, "I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. When it is conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Do not be distracted by my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of light, with whom there is no variance or shadows due to change. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of faith, that we should be a kind of first fruit of his creation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to stand now out of reverence toward the Holy Gospel, and as we sing the Alleluia and verse. Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." The Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild animals, and the angels were ministering to him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I invite you to be seated for our sermon hymn, "Christ Be My Leader." Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Is God for us or is God against us? Many people, including probably you and me too, find hope in the verse that comes from Romans chapter 8. It's verse 31. And it says, if God is for us, then who could be against us? Of course, Paul's point there is that God is for us. But what if it seems like even God is against us? I think we all have these moments in our lives when things just get worse and worse, and it seems like even God is out to get us, right? Today, I can imagine that many of you are like me, frustrated with the government restrictions that continue to go on and on. And so perhaps this is an example of a time when we wonder if God really is for us. We certainly have to wonder why God allows his own church to suffer under these restrictions, and the whole world for that matter. The question may come at this point then, are we as the church being tested by God? Abraham, if we look at his life, Abraham is a prime example of what it is like and what it feels like to be tested by God, and what it feels like as if God is working against you. He knew what it was like to be tested by God. After years of waiting for a son, him and his wife Sarah finally had Isaac, and things couldn't have been better for them. They didn't even think that they would be blessed with a child because Sarah was barren for quite some time. But they gladly received and they enjoyed this beautiful blessing from the Lord. And then God tells Abraham to sacrifice this son as a burnt offering. What's with that? This is a hard story to take in for many of us, and I certainly can understand that. Why would God ask Abraham to sacrifice his only son? It seems very cruel. Is God for Abraham, or is he against Abraham? Another great example of testing that we heard today is Jesus and his temptation by Satan. You see, we are told by Mark that Jesus is led out into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit deliberately takes Jesus out to where Satan was so that he would be tempted. And no, God does not tempt Jesus, but he does lead Jesus out to be tempted by Satan himself. Is God for Jesus then, or is God against Jesus? Why does God test Jesus so severely? What about our lives? How is God testing us today? Perhaps all the church restrictions is a test from God, and sometimes we can get pretty focused on doing things in the church and forget about what we are to do outside of the church as God's people. And I know I am guilty of this for sure. I like to stay in my office. It's cozy and comfortable and warm, especially in the winter time. Yes, the restrictions are frustrating, as they have prevented us from gathering comfortably in our church building, but this has only highlighted the need for the gospel to be proclaimed outside of the church in our world today, especially as the messages of the world always seem to be so negative. This is what people in our world are constantly hearing, these negative messages. In our North American culture, we seem to have lost the urgency of the gospel message. And to be honest, I'm still trying to figure this out too, how to do this effectively and how to evangelize effectively outside in the world. It is scary to think of proclaiming the gospel to strangers outside of the church. They might not accept the message, right? But I continue to see the urgent need for many Christians, including us, to be bold not just in the church, but outside of the church as well. And so we'll probably continue over the many years to figure this out. Perhaps God is also testing each one of us in this divided world on various hot-button topics. There are many controversial topics today, and if you take a stand on one, you certainly will be tested. Speaking against abortion is unpopular today. Speaking against something like doctor-assisted suicide is unpopular. Certainly, basically anything that tells others what they should or shouldn't do is unpopular today. And so as Christians, you may have to sacrifice friendships or other relationships over certain views that you might have. And it's getting to the point now where many Christians may have to sacrifice jobs as well and their livelihoods for their views. We have seen quite a few of the famous people in Hollywood who were fired for unpopular opinions on controversial topics. And just because it's happening in Hollywood doesn't mean that it can't happen in our own community. Christianity has some very unpopular teachings in today's society. And so we may also find ourselves sacrificing jobs because of our views. And will this be, is this all a test from God? Perhaps. Well, there may be other ways that God is testing you as well, and perhaps you know best for yourselves how God is testing you. Maybe he's testing your patience, testing your knowledge, perhaps he's testing your finances. Whatever it may be, God is likely testing you in some area of your life. At least you might feel that way. But why does God test us? Why does God feel the need to test us? Is God for us or is God against us? I'm going to jump back to Abraham now. Abraham passes the test from God. The reward for him is great. God blessed Abraham and promised that his offspring would greatly multiply. And this was God's promise to Abraham from the beginning, that his offspring would be very great. And so when it came time for the test then, Abraham trusted that God would keep his promise. And if Isaac was his only son then, something had to happen to spare his son. After all, God promised Abraham that he would have many descendants. And Abraham knew that God was for him and not against him. And knowing that God was for him, he trusted that even if he sacrificed his only son, then that God had a plan to keep his promise. Not only does God keep his promise to Abraham, but Abraham also gets to keep his beloved son Isaac, who he must have loved greatly, I'm sure. Still, it is easy for us to view God as cruel when we hear this story. We often question, why would God even ask Abraham to kill his only son? Why would God even consider this a good idea, right? For this, we should also consider another question that I think really puts this all to light. Why would God the Father sacrifice his only son? Especially for people who are sinners, who rebel against God all the time. Why would God feel the need to sacrifice his only son, right? Speaking of God's only son, Jesus, let's take a look at him then too again and what we heard about Jesus today from Mark. All that Mark says is that Jesus was tempted for 40 days. And then Mark moves on to with the story of Jesus as Jesus begins his ministry. It's kind of funny because you would think that it would be an important thing to note that Jesus did not give in to the temptations of Satan, but Mark doesn't tell us this. Luckily, though, we can look to Matthew and Luke, and they tell us that Jesus used the Old Testament scriptures and defeated the temptations of Satan. And so Jesus was triumphant over the temptations of Satan. This gives us a glimpse into why the Holy Spirit would lead Jesus to Satan. Why God would test Jesus so severely. Because he himself, Jesus himself, was God. And if all the sins of the world were to be forgiven, then God himself would have to be tempted by Satan as a man. Being both man and God, Jesus was able to defeat the temptations of Satan and take back the power that Satan had over God's creation. You see, God was for Jesus, not against Jesus. Of course, it helps that Jesus was God, but we too are God's creation, and Jesus has defeated Satan's temptations on our behalf as a man and God. So why are we still tested by God in our lives? Why does God allow Satan to tempt us in our lives today? Is God for us, or is God against us? God is certainly for us. And though we do face testing from God, the test is actually already passed. Christ defeated temptation, and Christ passed the test for us. And this is the whole point of the good news of Jesus Christ. And so the only test now for us is to cling to Christ always. As James says in his epistle, "Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him." You see, God has already promised us the crown of life. All that is required is being steadfast to Jesus. And how do we do this? How do we stay steadfast to Jesus? Well, you could put it in many ways, but what Scripture continually says is that anyone who believes in Jesus Christ will be saved. And so being steadfast in Christ means believing in him and trusting in him, even when things are seemingly falling apart in our lives. So just as Abraham trusted that God was for him, we ought to trust that God is for us. Just as Jesus willingly went out into the wilderness to meet with Satan, trusting that the Father was for him, we ought to trust that God is for us. In whatever trial we face, may we be able to see that God has a plan for us and that God is for us and working with us. May God keep you steadfast then under the many trials of our world today and through the many temptations of Satan so that you may receive the crown of life. God has defeated Satan and his temptations through his Son, Jesus Christ. And he promises to give you that crown of life. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue with our next hymn, 424, O Christ, You Walked the Road.
You faced it, thus temptations passed.
invite you to stand now as we confess our faith through the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue with the prayer of the church. I've changed it this Sunday, so when I say, "Let us pray to the Lord," you can respond with, "Lord, have mercy." In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the Lord to remember us according to his steadfast love and goodness in Christ, and to instruct and lead us by his Holy Spirit, that we may repent and believe the gospel, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the Lord who placed the wood of the cross on the back of his only begotten Son to bless his church, for all who are called to preach and teach with the certain hope of Christ, and for all, and for bold faith for all Christians, that they may trample every power of the enemy underfoot. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. To the Father of lights, from whom every good and perfect gift comes, that he would keep us from being enticed by our own desires, for his help to use his gifts rightly in service to him and our neighbor, and for him to bless all leaders, that we may be governed wisely and justly for the good of this present generation and all those to come. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all children and their parents and every Christian home, that God would preserve them from the assaults of the evil one. And as Christ overcame Satan in the desert, by the word of God, give us the victory through him and his word. For the Lutheran Early Learning Center and all its staff and children, that your name would continue to be preached boldly in all of its daycares. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. To the Most High, who is our refuge in every trouble and has promised to hear us when we call, that he would command his angels to guard our brothers and sisters this day. We especially pray for Susan, Alice, Tabitha, Ben, Linda, Thor, Bill, Irene, Linda, Jim, Larry, Charmaine, Olinda, John, Terry, Haley, Rachel, Mike, Alex, or Ken, Anne, Dale, Albert, Nora, Dorothy, Allison, Michelle, Karen, Ruby, Elizabeth, and Bev. And we pray for all those who we name in our hearts as well at this time. For all those who suffer in our midst, keep them from every evil that can befall the body, mind, and soul. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who commune here, since the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand, as his beloved Son comes to us here at the altar, that God would enable us to receive Christ in repentance and believe the gospel proclaimed to us in his body and his blood. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. In thanksgiving for those before us whom God brought forth by the word of truth and who now live and reign in his presence with his Son, and that the Lord would bring us to full maturity by this same word, that we too may be gathered with them to his Son on the glorious harvest of the last day. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, give to us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We will not be passing around the offering plate. If you wish to give your offering, it is at the back of the sanctuary. So we'll continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feasts in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and to be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, to renew and to strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Please be seated. Take and eat. This is the true body of Christ given into death for you. Take and drink. The true blood of Christ shed for the forgiveness of all your sins. And now may the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul unto life everlasting. Go in his peace. Amen. And for those who were unable to be here today and to receive the sacrament, receive a blessing from the Lord. May God preserve you and keep you from all trials and temptations of this world and lead you to everlasting life. Amen. And so we continue. I invite you to stand now as we give thanks to God for this glorious gift that he has given us through his body and blood, as we sing the Nunc Dimittis. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. We pray this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. I invite you to be seated now as we close with our final hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Bye.
peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Shine.